Well, give the choir another hand, will you? That's pretty cool. I love the worship. We had great worship at Elgin this morning, and now I get to be here, and just so excited for what God is doing in this place and in this church at all of the campuses. And I couldn't come to the worship night back a couple weeks ago. I was out of town, and I tried everything I could to get here, and I couldn't be here for the worship night. And I said something to Vertical. I said, man, I hated I couldn't be there. They said, that's okay. We recorded it for you. And I don't think they recorded it for me, but I'm glad that they recorded it, and I'll be anxious in a few months when that comes out. Well, we're in a brand new series. If you were here last weekend, then you know we are embarking on a very deliberate verse-by-verse walkthrough of the Gospel of Mark. And we're very excited about that journey because it causes us to focus on Jesus, just Jesus, and that's it. The Bible quotes Jesus as saying, "And I, if I be lifted up, will draw all people unto me." And that's what we hope will happen for many of you. We hope will happen for your unchurched friends who will come to these services with you, that all of us will be drawn to Jesus. Not to a set of religious rituals and legalistic behaviors, not to fluffy programming void of biblical truth, not to a leader, not to a campus, but we want people to be drawn to Jesus Christ. And He is the one. He is the godly man, a manly God. He is the one who is the promised Messiah. He is the Son of the living God. He is the servant leader who shows us how to live. And last week, Pastor Ed had a great message, and he challenged us to memorize a passage of Scripture throughout this series. It's kind of a theme verse. It's Mark chapter 10, verse 45. And I'm just going to ask you to read Mark 10, 45 with me out loud. Let's just read it. "For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." How different Jesus Christ was from others. Jesus Christ will show us a new way of doing life. And I want you to take your Bible, if you would, and turn to Mark chapter 1 and just keep it open. We're just going to work verse by verse through this passage, and we're going to cover 20 verses today. That's a lot of territory, but we're going to discover the new way that Jesus Christ makes available to people. Now, we begin with a passage that Ed alluded to last week, verses 14 and 15. "Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came into Galilee proclaiming the gospel of God and saying, 'The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel.'" Now, this is really cool because the type of language that Jesus uses piques the curiosity of the crowd. It begs for people to lean in and say, what is it that he's talking about? He's talking about the kingdom of God is at hand. He's saying that the time is near for all this to be fulfilled. And so it causes people to lean in. Years ago, someone studied the gospel accounts, and they landed on a couple of phrases to explain Christ's ministry. The phrases were, "come and see," and "go and tell." That's how Christ ministered. That's what everything was about. In other words, throughout Jesus' ministry, his miracles, his words, his interaction screamed, "come and see, move a little bit closer, investigate the evidence for yourself. You make an informed decision based on your coming closer and seeing for yourself." And then after you've taken that closer look, Jesus' strategy is for you to go and tell. In other words, you'll be so convinced of who Jesus is and what he's done for you that you want to go and tell. You don't have to share about Jesus out of duty. You now want to do it out of devotion. You don't do it because, I have to do that. You do it because you want to do that. It's what's in your heart. And early on in this series, I just want to encourage you that this is a safe place for you to bring your unchurched guests and just to invite people to come and see. And if you do, we will make this promise to you. If you bring people, we will make certain that Jesus Christ is front and center. Your guests will see the value of worshiping and singing to the Lord. They will see numerous volunteers and super servants like we have at every one of our campuses. They may even enjoy the preaching. But more importantly, they will encounter the Christ of the cross. And it's our prayer that they will then follow your lead and that then they will go and tell. Look back in your Bible at our text as we continue, verses 16 through 20. Passing alongside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew, the brother of Simon, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you become fishers of men." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. And going on a little farther, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, who were in their boats mending their nets. And immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired servants, and they followed him. They followed Jesus. So I'm going to give you six lessons. Here's lesson number one that this radical teacher is going to give us. He inspires loyalty. Jesus inspires loyalty. All four of these men walked away from their livelihood in order to follow Jesus. Now, on the surface, it might look like, oh, well, I guess this was a total stranger. Jesus just walks up and all of a sudden he says something to them and they immediately follow him. Well, you have to look at all the Gospels together and you find various details in different Gospel accounts. We learn that in John's Gospel account that Andrew meets Jesus and has an interaction with him. He goes back and gets Peter and brings him back and says, "We have found the Messiah. We have found the Messiah." And so there are different things that have taken place prior to this so that the people can really get to know Jesus a little bit. Mark's is more of an overview of this part of the story, and Mark says Jesus walked past, and he did do this at one point, and said, "Follow me." And at that point, they were convinced. They dropped their nets, and they left what they were doing. They left their livelihood behind them. Now, none of the 12 were worthy of Jesus' calling. Few, if any, were of noble background. None of them had any religious clout. This is a ragtag team. Four of the disciples were fishermen. One of them, Simon the Zealot, not Simon Peter, but Simon the Zealot, was part of a political group that sought to overthrow the Roman government. Matthew, let's talk about Matthew for a minute. Matthew worked for the Roman government as a tax collector and would have been viewed essentially as a traitor to every Jewish person. You see, back then, Rome found countrymen who were seared in their conscience. In other words, these were people who loved money more than they loved people, more than they loved God. And so they would have the opportunity through dishonesty and pure force to take money from people that didn't belong to them and then to give a share of it to the Roman government. In fact, it was so lucrative of a business that the people that would become a tax collector would actually bid to be able to be at a particular intersection. The busier the intersection, the more money that they could make. And as a person came walking past, they could hit them up for taxes if they hadn't done so recently. And they could make up any story they want. And they had Roman soldiers right there beside them, and you didn't have any choice in the matter. In fact, if you look through the Gospels, every time you see the word tax collector, it is always in a list with some of the most vile of sinners that you could ever imagine. That's the way they viewed a tax collector. And yet Jesus Christ goes up to Matthew and says, "I see something in you. I want you on my team. Will you follow me?" It gives me hope. It gives you hope to think that Jesus would take a chance on somebody like that, that he could use you. This was a new way for a rabbi to go about things. This time Jesus chose them, hand-selected personal invitation. We talked about this a couple of months ago. We talked about how it's very different from the rabbinical system, because in the rabbinical system, a student would go to a rabbi who they liked their teaching, and the student would go and say, "Hey, I'd like to follow you." And then they would become a follower of that person. And that's the way every rabbi operated, but not Jesus. Instead, Jesus went to the student, just the opposite. That's why on the night when Jesus is about to be betrayed and he'll be dead within 24 hours, he looks at his disciples in John chapter 15, verse 16. And this is what he says to them. He says, "You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit and that your fruit should abide." So Jesus says, make certain you understand, you didn't choose me, I chose you. I walked along those boats and I said, "Follow me." I came to your tax collecting booth and I said, "Follow me," and you chose to do it. Years ago, there was a man who was kind of adversarial and cynical to the Bible. And one time he chided a preacher by asking, "If Jesus really was the Son of God, I mean, if Jesus really was perfect, then why in the world would he choose Judas to be one of his followers?" And the Christian man thought for a second before he answered, and then he said this, "From my perspective, the greater mystery that deserves an explanation is, why did Jesus choose me in all of my sinfulness?" And that's the question that every one of us wrestles with. And the only logical explanation is unconditional love. Look back in your Bible at the next verse, verse 21. It says, "And they went into Capernaum, and immediately on the Sabbath, he entered the synagogue and was teaching. And they were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one who had authority and not as the scribes." So here's lesson number two. His teaching had authority. This is what stood out to people. His teaching was astonishing. Crowds would travel far and wide. Young Jewish men would choose a rabbi to follow based upon the unique variations of the rabbi's philosophy or approach. And they looked for someone who wasn't just a flash in the pan, but actually had substance. And on rare occasions, they would say that they had come across a rabbi who had authority, who had shmiha. That was the word, shmiha. Let me hear you say that. One, two, three. Shmiha. That's a fun word to say, isn't it? It kind of makes you smile when you say shmiha. But when Jesus was noticed that he was distinctive because of the fact that he had shmiha, it caused everyone to come and see. Everyone had to lean in. Why? Because there was something different about him. Jesus demonstrated his authority in every scenario, whoever he was with. When Jesus was with the religious leaders who were trying to bring him down, when Jesus was with the disciples who he was trying to teach, when Jesus was with the masses who he was trying to point them toward eternal life, every time he showed that he had authority. Matthew chapter 28, verse 18. Harvest loves this passage of scripture. It says, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me." Why does Jesus say that? He wants to make certain that there's no question. This is not a wrestling match of who's in charge. If you become a Christ follower, you are saying, "You are my Lord, you are my master. I am your servant." Look at verse 23 of our text. "And immediately there was in the synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, 'What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God.' But Jesus rebuked him, saying, 'Be silent and come out of him.' And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying out with a loud voice, came out of him. And they were all amazed, so that they questioned among themselves, saying, 'What is this? A new teaching with authority. He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him.'" Lesson number three, his actions have supremacy. His actions have supremacy. The word used here where it says that they were all amazed is a term that's used quite sparingly. The writers of the New Testament rarely use it, and if they do, typically it is when they're describing the response of others to Jesus. Because everything he does stands in stark contrast to what people normally heard from teachers. But now, they see demons obey him and flee. Now they've just turned into and moved into a whole nother realm, a whole nother hemisphere. And then on top of that, to hear an unclean spirit refer to Jesus as the Holy One of God. Wow, this would be a moment to be there. This is an epic battle. This is a showdown. This is good versus evil. This is the ultimate contest. And as always, when it's Jesus versus Satan, it's no contest. Hands down, Jesus Christ will win every single time. He always has. He always will. Now, you're maybe skeptical of Christianity, and first of all, thank you for being here. I'm glad that you're putting yourself in a situation where you can find out answers to some of your questions that you have. But if you're skeptical of Christianity, you might be rolling your eyes at this point and saying, well, you know, I see Satan as more as a mythical character conjured up to kind of complete the package of the enemy of God. And you realize that there's evil out there, but you're not willing to buy into the person or the power of Satan. Even though the Bible clearly states time and time again that Satan exists. The skeptic explains it away the same way someone might explain away the tooth fairy or Santa Claus. But Satan is not a figment of our imagination. And the Bible teaches that Satan was an angel in heaven who allowed pride to consume him. And so he was cast out of heaven. That's why we call him a fallen angel. Satan is a literal supernatural being. The Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8, it says, Be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. And he's been roaming the earth ever since the Garden of Eden, when he enticed Eve into eating forbidden fruit. He incited David to choose a mistress. He plagued Job with affliction. He tempted Jesus in the wilderness. He entered Judas' heart. He tormented Paul with a thorn in the flesh. Each of those people would tell you that Satan is alive and that he has extensive power and that Satan desires to destroy us. But you don't need to journey back to the first century to know that Satan is alive. I encounter him on a daily basis. Sometimes I feel like I encounter him on an hourly basis as he appeals to my flesh. A number of years ago, it was on New Year's Eve. I'll never forget it. I pulled into my driveway and my headlights hit the garbage cans, and there was a big possum that was crawling out of my garbage can, and he scurried into our backyard. And I was very excited because now I knew who the culprit was, who was responsible for tearing up my garbage the past few weeks. So I went inside and I got my golf bag and I grabbed my 3-iron. And I struggled to hit my 3-iron in real life on a golf course, so I thought, well, I'll just kind of go out in the backyard and see where this guy is. Well, he climbed up a tree, a small tree with no branches on it. He was trying to be very inconspicuous there, like I couldn't see him. And so I took my 3-iron, and I just reached up there, and I poked him, and I prodded him a couple of times. But when I did that, he immediately got in an attack position, and he showed me his fangs, and he made a hissing noise, and he proceeded to prepare to pounce on my head. And so I chose to retreat and try a different route. And so I came inside, I called a buddy of mine up who lives on a farm, and I said, John, I said, you have a cage that I could catch a possum? And he said, sure, come over the next few days, get a cage. So I did, and I put that in my backyard. It's a big thing with my family. I put some food around the cage, and sure enough, nothing happened. I mean, no possum. Went near it for the next few days. And so I called up John. I said, dude, nothing's happening. He said, well, let me ask you a question. Are you changing the menu? I said, what? He said, are you changing the menu? He said, you have to find something that he really likes. He said, just keep trying different things. So sure enough, I put some pizza out that night. And I had pizza leading into the cage, and I had pizza inside the cage. Next morning, I came out. The pizza was gone outside the cage, but it was still in there on the inside. So my family, we got real excited about this, and it became a big event for us. The next day, we went out, and my family, we put ground beef out there. Well, he ate it going in, but he didn't eat it inside of the cage. But on the third day, we put ham out there. Next morning, my wife's at the kitchen sink. She said, we got him. We got the possum. I'm telling you what, there was a celebration. It was unbelievable. I got the family bundled up. We went outside. And as soon as that possum saw me,
He exposed his fangs and hissed. He remembered me. And so we came out, and it was such a big deal for us. I even took a family picture of it, all right? I mean, you got to chronicle something like this. This is big time stuff, okay? And now, granted, I live in Kentucky. There's not a lot of exciting things in Kentucky, all right? This was the highlight of my year, okay? And here's a picture of the possum when he saw me and recognized me. Yeah, he was not a happy camper. So now I got this possum. How am I going to get rid of him? So I didn't know what to do. So I called up our student pastor. I figured he had a lot of experience with wild animals. And I said, can you help me out? And I was a little terrified of the little dude. So sure enough, he said, yeah, come on over. I'll help you get rid of him. So I'll never forget when I drove over to Jim's house, when I pulled up, he came walking out. He had a football helmet on, was carrying a shotgun. And we drove about 5 miles away. We found a wooded area, and we opened up the cage and ran like little junior high girls. And eventually the little guy came out and headed into the woods, where then eventually he could destroy more families' lives. But as the story of the capture and release began to circulate among my circle of friends, people began all to ask me one question. There was one question that they wanted to ask. Is it tough to catch a possum? Is it difficult to trap a possum? And you know what I answered every one of them with? I said, not really. You just have to keep changing the menu until finally you find something that they can't resist. And that is exactly how Satan operates. He will do whatever he can, and he will continue to change the menu in an effort to change the faithful to the faithless. And at first he might entice you with someone's appearance, and then it may be for the opportunity for influence. And then if that fails, it might be someone with affluence, and maybe he gets you coveting their affluence, and it's where you think of having material things is more important than having integrity. You see, Satan took a lesson from Jesus' game plan, and Satan loves to play the come and see game as well. And he tries to attract us to things, and he tries to pull you into his cage. And if you don't go the first time, that's okay. He's not thrown off. He knows what he's doing. He'll just keep changing the menu until he finds something that you can't resist. And he tracks, and he tricks, and he traps. Solomon said it well. The example that he gives in Proverbs chapter 7 is that of adultery. He says, with persuasive words, she led him astray. She seduced him with her smooth talk. All at once, he followed her like an ox going to the slaughter, like a bird darting into a snare, little knowing it will cost him his life. And only by admitting your need for a Savior can the Spirit lead you from bondage to freedom. What I'm saying is this: Jesus has the supremacy, but you don't. And if you are playing games with Satan, and you are thinking that you can meet him in the flesh and just in your own willpower, you can withstand all the temptations he throws before you, you're wrong. Unless you're living by the Spirit, you're not going to win that battle. So hear me when I say, don't dabble with demons. Don't toy with temptation. Don't be seduced by sin. You put your hope and trust in the supremacy of Christ, because he has all power over everything, even the powers of darkness. And when you gave your life to Jesus Christ, Jesus chose to take up residency in your life. The Holy Spirit lives inside of you. And now you can conquer sin, not because of you, but because of Christ. Look back in your Bible at verse 28 of our text. And at once his fame spread everywhere throughout all the surrounding region of Galilee. So the next lesson that we find is his miracles bring him notoriety. All of a sudden, Jesus becomes so popular. This is early in his ministry. He gets notoriety. Why? Because of these miracles that he's performing. This is no sleight of hand. The crowds were well aware that Jesus was no charlatan. The miracles he was performing could not be replicated by someone doing magic. Most people, when they get attention, they want more attention. They want more of the spotlight. But Jesus was different. We typically see notoriety as a good thing, but you will see they can greatly impede a person's ability to go around and to be with crowds. And that's what Jesus was going to experience. That's why Jesus said on several different occasions, hey, don't tell anybody what I've done. He would do this miraculous healing, then he'd look at the person and say, hey, I know I just cleansed you from leprosy, but don't go tell anybody. Oh, how's that going to work, right? But Jesus said that so that he would have the freedom to be able to move around unimpeded to reach out to people. Have you ever noticed that sometimes the more popular a person gets, the more they start to retreat from that spotlight? Why is that? It's because people can be draining. And we'll learn in this series that Jesus himself pulls away from people, but he does it for an awesome reason. And you'll find that out in the next couple of weeks. Y'all know Bill Murray. Bill Murray is known to you all as a Chicago Cubs fan. He came from Chicago. Maybe you think of Bill Murray when he's at the Pebble Beach Pro-Am, and you see him just interacting with the crowds and having so much fun. When I think of Bill Murray, I think of just an incredible actor, and it's probably because of the deep intellectual roles that he has in all of his movies, right? Caddyshack, Ghostbusters, Groundhog Day. I just found out Groundhog Day was filmed in Chicago. One more reason for me to love Chicago, right? And my favorite film of all time is a Bill Murray film. That's What About Bob? It's a classic. They're going to just show that in heaven constantly. Amen? Right, yeah. But I've learned some things in recent months about Bill Murray that I didn't know. There was a documentary done of his life where they didn't even interview Bill Murray, but they interviewed all these people where he had just randomly reached out and just encouraged people. Just wherever he was, he dropped what he was doing, and he just reached out. He didn't let notoriety keep him from being who he really was. One time, Bill Murray was in a city, and he was just driving through this town, and he saw all these cars lined up, and he saw people getting out of their cars, coming in, and he said, well, they must be having a party there, so he thought, I guess I'll just go to the party. And so, sure enough, he walked in with some other guests, and when he got in there, people started saying, what in the world is Bill Murray doing here? And he said, hey, where's the host and hostess? And so they found the host and hostess. They were in the kitchen, and they were doing dishes. And Bill Murray said, hey, he said, you know what? I'm here for your party. He said, why don't you guys go out and be with all of your guests so that they get to be with you, and I'll do your dishes so you don't have to worry about that. And so they went to be with their guests, and Bill Murray stood there and did dishes for over an hour, and then when no one was looking, he left just as quietly as he had come. Another time he was in the city, and he was in a bar, and when he was there, the bar was jam-packed. There weren't enough workers there, and so after a while, he just got up, and he went to the back and said, hey, y'all, could you use an extra bartender? And they said, sure. Do you know how to bartend? He said, well, let me help out. And he went around asking everybody what they wanted for their drink. He brought every single person a drink. None of them got what they had asked for. But they all left happy, right? And they had a memory with Bill Murray, my favorite story. He flew into San Francisco from Chicago. When he got to San Francisco, he had a 90-minute trip with a taxi. And once he got in with his cabbie, he started asking the guy questions. He said, well, let me ask you something. He said, what do you like to do? And the cabbie said, well, he said, I like to play the saxophone. And Bill Murray said, are you pretty good at it? He said, no, he said, I'm really not. He said, how can I be good? He said, when I drive a cab 14 hours a day. He said, well, where's your saxophone? He said, it's in the trunk of my cab. He said, well, pull over. He said, I want you to get it out. So the cabbie pulled over, went back. As he's opening up his trunk, Bill Murray slipped into the front seat, took the driver's seat, locked the door. The guy came back in. He said, get in the back seat. Bill Murray drove for 90 minutes while the guy practiced his saxophone in the back seat. Somebody heard about that story and interviewed Bill Murray a few months later and said, hey, did this really happen? He said, yeah, it happened. He said, why in the world did you do it? And Bill Murray looked back at the guy like he was crazy. He said, well, it was obvious. He said, the guy doesn't get a chance to practice. He told me he doesn't get a chance to practice. He's not very good. I can't teach him the saxophone, but I do know how to drive a car. So he said, why not I drive while he practices? Story after story, the common thread in every story is Bill Murray always makes the other person the object of attention, and he does something that impacts them. Popularity didn't change the person. Notoriety didn't change his identity. I have no idea if Bill Murray has any faith. I don't know why he does those things, but here's what I do know. He serves selflessly, and he makes memories for people by making himself available. And when a person does that, they give you a glimpse of Jesus Christ. Because that's what Jesus did. And that's what Jesus will do all throughout the Gospel of Mark. And that's what he does here. He's been in the synagogue healing people right and left. Look back in your Bible at verse 29. Verse 29, and then immediately, there's that word immediately again, the pastor Ed said was going to be in here. He left the synagogue and entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law lay ill with a fever, and immediately they told him about her. And he came and took her by the hand and lifted her up, and the fever left her, and she began to serve them. Lesson number 5, he heals compassionately. He heals compassionately. That's who Jesus is. And his compassionate love wasn't just for the crowds. It was for the individual too. And he healed people and he poured into them one at a time. Jesus is no respecter of persons. When he walked the earth, he treated everyone the same. He goes to Simon Peter's mother-in-law, who is very sick with a fever. She's down and out until Jesus intervenes. And when his hand touches hers, the fever's gone. It's such a dramatic transformation that Mark tells us that she immediately got up and began serving others. Now, a fever, it wipes you out of your strength. You don't get up and serve. You lay down and you let other people serve you. How could she do that? Well, she had had an encounter with Jesus and she would never be the same. His compassion comes out as he serves this woman and changes her. There's an old hymn we used to sing when I was a kid. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. And it's true. He's going to treat you the same. And here's a thought that there is nothing that God can do to make him love you more. There's no way that God can show love to you more than how he already has. Once a person has been willing to die for you, you can't one-up that, right? That's as high as it gets. Look at your next verse, verse 32. And 33, that evening at sundown, so let me just backtrack. He's been healing in the synagogue all day. He now comes to Simon Peter's mother-in-law's house, heals her. Now look at the next thing he does. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or oppressed by demons, and the whole city was gathered together at the door. Lesson number 6. His schedule has availability. So they found out where he was staying, and the whole city, the Bible says, came out to him. When Jesus makes his presence known, he will always cause a stir. But here's my question for you. Do you have margin in your life? Can you drop what you're doing in order to minister and serve someone else and pour into them? Jesus made margin. He had to be exhausted. And then all of a sudden, the whole town is there at his front door, and they're just waiting to be healed. This morning, I was having breakfast at a hotel, and I had met the gal who was a cook that kind of fills the area of the buffet, and I'd met her the day before. And so she was out, and I was talking with her some, and I was kind of in a hurry to get to church. And so we didn't have a long time to visit. But I said to her, I said, hey, will you do me a favor? I said, you just be praying for me. I'm going to actually preach a sermon. I'm a pastor. I'm going to go preach a sermon. And she looked at me, and she dropped everything she was doing. And here we are in the middle of a crowded restaurant, right in the area where everybody could see us. She dropped what she was doing, and she began to pray for me right there. And she prayed, Lord, may the Holy Spirit come over him. And may he preach Jesus. She had margin in her life. I don't know what her boss thought of what she was doing. I don't know what other customers thought. But it meant the world to me. Do you have margin in your life? Is there availability in your schedule, or are you like me? You got to cut the conversation short. I got to get to church. Well, maybe church wasn't the most important thing. Maybe it was talking with her. Obviously, it was her praying with me that God knew that I needed. You might say, well, yeah, but I know God is extremely busy. I mean, he's got a lot going on. There's a lot on his day timer, and I don't know that he's got time for me. If I were to speak to him or pray to him or ask for something, I mean, he might see that as an interruption. No, I don't think God's up there saying, oh, I can't believe it, another request from Chicagoland. Whoa, here we go again. Okay, sorry about the weather. We'll do better next time. No, I don't know what he's up there doing. He's not saying, not now, I don't have time for you. Instead, he doesn't see you as an interruption. He sees this as an opportunity for a father to communicate with his children. And so when you reach out to him, for him, it is fulfilling. It brings him great joy. Psalm chapter 27, verse 10, the psalmist says, for my father and my mother have forsaken me, but the Lord will take me in. In other words, regardless of who abandons us, who betrays us, who hurts us, the Lord is ready, willing, and able to embrace us. He's always available. So go and tell others of a God who is as close as your whisper. Did you notice that this passage includes several just different miracles of Jesus exorcising demons time and time again? It's 3 or 4 times in here. And this would have been a miracle that would just be a demonstrative display by the divine. He had the power to silence demons. Nobody could silence a demon. Only Jesus could. I personally don't believe that a person can be demon-possessed without first inviting Satan into their life. I don't know if it was different back then. I don't know why there seemed to be more people who were demon-possessed back in Bible times. But I do know that Satan cannot inhabit where he is not made to feel welcome. And so today, if you are a believer in Jesus Christ who has surrendered your life to him, then you don't need to worry about that. You don't ever have to worry about that. There's an awesome passage of scripture in 1 John chapter 4, verse 4. It says, you, dear children, are from God and have overcome them, because the one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world. The Spirit of the Lord living inside of you, Jesus Christ living inside of you, is stronger than anything Satan can throw at you in this world. You are not a minority. You are in the majority when you meet Satan in the presence and company of the Spirit of God. Irwin McManus preaches in Los Angeles and spoke at a conference in Georgia a few years ago where he shared about a time when he sent his 9-year-old son, Aaron, to go to a church camp, a Christian camp in California. And McManus thought, oh, I thought this will be great. You know, I'll send him to a church camp and he'll grow in his faith. It'll be really, really great. Well, his son came home, and when he was tucking his son in bed after his first night of being away at camp, he started to turn the lights out. And he said, Dad, don't turn the lights out. He said, well, what's wrong? He said, no, I just want to sleep with the lights on tonight. He said, well, you weren't scared of the dark before you went to church camp. Why are you scared of the dark now? He said, wait a second. Did they tell you ghost stories? And he said, no, Dad. They didn't tell ghost stories. They told stories about the power of demons and the power of Satan. And Irwin McManus thought, oh, that's great. I should have sent him to a pagan camp where they would have told ghost stories. Then I could have just said, there's no such thing as ghosts. Don't worry about it. Don't sweat it, right? And turn out the light. But he said, instead, I sent him to a church camp. They had the audacity to tell him stories about the power of Satan. So what am I supposed to say? Well, you know what? They're right. Yeah. Satan is alive and well. He is powerful. He is the prince of darkness, son. Let me just tell you something. He has all sorts of people that work for him. He rules this earth. He utilizes countless demons who are invisible. They're all throughout our city. They're all throughout our subdivision. They're all throughout our house. They're even in this room. Good night. Oh. He said, no, I can't do that. He said, about that time, his son looked up at him with tears in his eyes and said, Dad. He said, Daddy, just pray that God will make me safe. Pray that God will make me safe. And Irwin McManus got down on his knees next to his son's bed. And he looked at his son and he said, I won't pray that prayer. Because he said, in my heart, it goes against everything. I don't want my son to live a safe life, a risk-free life. I want him to take big, bold risks for Christ. His son looked at him again and said, Daddy, pray that God will make me safe. And Irwin put his hand on his chest and said, I won't pray that God will keep you safe. But here's what I will pray. He said, I will pray that God will make you so dangerous that when you walk in a room, even the demons have to flee. He said, okay, Dad, then pray that God makes me really dangerous. Here's a prayer I want you to pray this week. I want you to pray, Lord, make me really dangerous. Make me really dangerous. Take me out of my comfort zone. Let me have a boldness. Help me not to walk in fear and on eggshells of what Satan might try to do in my life. But instead, Lord, give me the power, give me the strength to be so close to Jesus Christ, to rest in his resurrection, to rest in his Holy Spirit power. The Bible says the same power that raised Jesus from the dead lives inside of you if you're a Christ follower. That's incredible power. And that's the same type of power that we need to have each and every day in our workplace, in our home life, in our relationships. In exchange for your loyalty, Jesus has given us numerous opportunities to come and see just who he is and to earn your loyalty through his authority and through his supremacy, in spite of his notoriety and popularity. His loving compassion and him being consistently available to us all, that's a game changer. So now that you have come and you have seen, will you go and will you tell? And will you live a life that is so dangerous that even the demons must flee? Let's pray. Father in heaven, today we choose to get in the action, to get in following you. And when you say follow me, may we just drop our nets and just follow you. To say, I understand it in my head. I believe it in my heart. I will confess it with my mouth. I will express it through baptism into Christ. I will live it consistently, daily, so that the world may be attracted to Jesus. Just Jesus. So, Lord, we look to you because we know that the power of sin no longer has that power over us that it used to. Sin is broken. You have saved us because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. May we live a life that reflects that. It's in the powerful name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen.